Chapter in Luke chapter 2. I say the whole chapter. No, we're not going to read the whole chapter. We'll stop at verse 38. So we're going to start in verse 1 and read through verse 38. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said to the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word, for mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, Behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years. That's 84 years. So if she was married about 14, she was near about 105 years old. Which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she coming in that instant gave thanks likewise unto the Lord and spoke of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. Father, once again, we thank you for your precious word. And Lord, we just pray that your word would go forth this morning. Lord, we just pray that we would be able to preach the text, Lord God, that the word that you have placed before our eyes, Lord, the story when you sent the Redeemer of the world, Lord God, that it would be exposed, that it would be open, Lord, and that you would reveal truth to us through your word, oh Lord God, and that it would have an effect on the inside of our lives. We just give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. So, hey, look, I titled this morning's message, The Night That God Came Near. And one of the things that the first thing that I put on the screen was a map. And I just wanted to make the point, you know, you can see on the map some of the landmarks that we talk about a lot. You see the Sea of Galilee and the Jordan River and the Dead Sea down here. And you can see the reason I chose this map is, you know, Nazareth is probably somewhere around here. And then, or maybe a little bit off to the left. And then Bethlehem is somewhere down here in Judea. So you have Galilee, the area of Galilee, which was the northern portion. Judea was the southern portion. If you'll remember, he said that he was in Galilee, the region of Galilee, a city called Nazareth. He left from there and he came to Judea, which was the region, to a city called Bethlehem. And if you'll notice on the screen that you have, there's almost like a movement where they go this way, and then they come down, and I think that they came over here off to the left. But the main reason I wanted you to see this was because there was a series of mountains. You may not be able to see it real good on the screen, but there was a series of mountains right here that stood in the way. You couldn't just take a straight shot. And so you got to understand the topography and the geography of what we're talking about here. This isn't an easy trek is the point that I'm trying to make. And not only that, what they would have done is they would have come down into the Valley of Jordan. And so you're looking at rocks, and you're looking at ascents and descents and hilly and valley country. Amen. I want you to get a picture of what's going on here. Because this is a little bit of a strange phenomenon, to be honest with you. Because Joseph has his espoused wife. Now, that means that they haven't consummated their marriage. And if you'll remember anything that we talked about when we spoke about the Jewish wedding feast, what happens is that the husband comes to the bride, and there's a contractual agreement that takes place. A contract is signed, a payment is paid. Joseph would have already paid for his bride. They would have signed a contract, but at the same time, they had not consummated. And then, all of a sudden, the angel shows up and changes everything. And says, you're going to be with child. How can it be? I have known no man. You're going to be with child, and the Holy One's going to overcome you. And we know the story that Joseph was about to put her away. He was going to give her a letter of divorcement. Now, that goes to show you once again that they were legally married. In the Jewish mindset, once this was done, they were legally married. But at the same time, it wasn't until the bridegroom came back for the bride that they consummated their marriage. Similar concept eschatologically, meaning in end time events, that we're married to Jesus when we give our heart to him. The payment price has already been paid, amen? The negotiation's been done. When you put your faith in Christ, you're married to him, but it won't be consummated till he comes back from the Father's house to get his bride, amen? And that's the concept of really what you would think was going on here. And in other words, Joseph, under normal circumstances, would have been trying to prepare a place for his bride. But instead, tradition says, you won't find it in the scripture, she's riding on a donkey. She's riding on a donkey because it's about an 80-mile trek. And so it's very unlikely that she would have been able to walk 80 miles because the scripture told us that she was great with child and that she actually, the appointed time was that she delivered while they were in Bethlehem. And so I want you to know that it's a little bit strange that she's on this journey with Joseph. It's not normal. And I believe it has probably to do with the fact that she's probably being ostracized. I can't prove that. But in the community, when they found out that she was pregnant with child and they had not consummated their marriage yet, back then, I mean, I don't mean to use lingo, but it wasn't cool. You just didn't do that. And yet, nevertheless, that's the case. And so we see that they're traveling from up north down south to this city called Bethlehem. We're just talking about the story a little bit right now. And whenever I began to think about the story, this Christmas story, and I began to think about the town of Bethlehem, a lot of things start popping into my mind. The first thing is the name of the town. Does anybody else remember what the name of the town was? What it means, the word Bethlehem? It means house of bread. So the living bread from heaven is about to be born in the house of bread, which is also known as the city of David. Quite a grand journey to give birth to this child, wouldn't you think? I'm not even really talking about this journey right here. I'm talking about let's back up some thousands of years. If you'll remember the series we did on the book of Ruth. Do you remember the series? Anybody that was here for the book of Ruth, Bethlehem is rich with history. See, it was in Bethlehem that a widow named Ruth, who was a Moabite, she lost her husband because Naomi and her husband had left the house of bread because there was a famine in the land and had gone to Moab. And now Ruth had married one of their sons, but the son died, and now Ruth is left alone. And what she chooses to do, this young Moabite woman, is she says, I'm not going to continue on with everything that I knew in the past. I'm going to forsake everything that I knew, and I'm going to connect myself to my mother-in-law Naomi and the God that she serves. And young Ruth went back with her mother-in-law to Bethlehem, and providence would have her light upon a field of a rich man named Boaz, who the Bible calls a kinsman redeemer. And Boaz, the kinsman redeemer, purchases Ruth, marries Ruth, and oh, hallelujah, Ruth and Boaz have a son named Obed, and Obed has a son named Jesse, and Jesse has a son named David, and both Joseph and Mary are from the house of David. And here they travel back because it's census time to go and to give, be counted under this census that's taking place. Now, one of the things that also hit me and I started to think was this. Many times there's things that are going on in your life in the natural that force you in a certain direction. You don't really understand why it is that things are happening the way that they are. Nevertheless, things are happening, and it kind of pushes you, it kind of corrals you into a certain area, and you find yourself heading in a certain direction. And later on, you realize the reason that that happened was that God's hand was actually behind it. It wasn't an accident that Ruth ended up in that field. And many times it's not an accident that you ended up where it was that you were at that particular time. And many times you can look backwards. The point that I'm trying to make is this, is that Joseph is hurriedly, urgently moving towards Bethlehem, where most commentators agree he would have owned some property, in order to be present for this census. Little does he know, at least I don't believe he does, that he's actually fulfilling a prophecy. Micah 5:2, where it says, O Bethlehem of Judah, though you be the smallest among the thousands of Judah, yet out of you, I'm paraphrasing, will come the one that I have chosen to rule. He will come out of Bethlehem. And so, without even realizing it, God has divinely orchestrated events and circumstances in order to cause Joseph and his espoused wife to head south towards Bethlehem so that the Christ child could be born in Bethlehem, so that the prophecy of Micah chapter 5 verse 2, which took place hundreds of years before Jesus' birth, would and could be fulfilled. God has things that are going on, and he's orchestrating things in your life that you don't even realize are taking place. But at the same time, I'm telling you, he's sovereign and he's in control. Amen. And you and I need to learn how to trust him. And so they find themselves in this particular circumstance where we know the story. There's no room in the inn. And they find themselves in this place, and the babe is wrapped in swaddling clothes. And at the same time, there were shepherds that were also in the country. And we see in the scripture where, it also talks about the fact that she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes. And we are told once again that there were shepherds in the country. And really, I wanted to kind of focus, that was kind of just my introduction. I wanted to focus a little bit on the shepherds, and I wanted to try to look a little bit at Simeon, and I also wanted to look at Anna. But in the life of the shepherds, they're kind of just doing what it is that they do. They're shepherds, and they're abiding in the field. The word abide means to live somewhere, to dwell somewhere. That's what shepherds did. They would stay out in the field for weeks at a time. They lived out there. They slept out there. They lived with the animals. You know, it's amazing how time changes things. And the reason I say that is because at the time frame of Jesus, shepherds were considered outcasts of society. And the reason they were considered outcasts of society is because they were considered ceremonially unclean. Because you see, the law said that if you touch a dead carcass, you're unclean. And you're unclean until you can bring an animal as a sacrifice so that you can be made ceremonially clean. Well, the problem is that if you're out in the field, you don't have time to get to the temple. And so now you're separated and you're ostracized and you're looked down upon. But is it not amazing that the very occupation of a shepherd was some of the greatest men of God that ever lived in Israel in times past? the very father of the faith, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, shepherds, the greatest king that Israel ever had, a shepherd out of 2 Samuel chapter 7. God told David, I took you out of the sheep cote, meaning I took you from the flock of the sheep where you were following the sheep around so that I could make you a ruler over my people. And yet, at the same time, now in this time frame, whenever Jesus is being born, shepherds are looked down upon. Not only that, but Jesus himself would be known as the good shepherd. Hallelujah. John chapter 10, verses 10 and 11. The thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I have come that they might have life and have life more abundantly. I'm the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And so we find ourselves in this circumstance where these shepherds are outcasts in society. And you know, I don't know about you, but I try to relate. How is it that people feel today? There's a lot of people that feel like they're outcasts. There's a lot of people that feel unworthy. And it's because they don't know Jesus. They're going through life and they're doing their thing and they just really don't know the Lord. But what I will tell you is this, is that one thing that all of these people have in common is that they all were waiting. They were all waiting in anticipation for the day that God's promises would come forth. You understand what I'm trying to tell you? The people of Israel knew that Israel had been given a promise of a redeemer, a promise of a seed of a woman out of Genesis, a promise of the seed of Abraham, a promise of the seed of Judah, a promise of the seed of David, a promise that the seed would be born of a virgin, a promise that the seed would be born in Bethlehem. What I'm trying to say is that God repeatedly told Israel that he was coming and that he had a plan, and they were waiting on Messiah, the anointed one, to show up. And that's what happens. The angel shows up while the shepherds are there, and he tells them, "Good, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." It's not just going to be for Israel. It's going to be for all people. Amen. He goes on to say in verse 11, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." Amen. You know, the word Savior literally means a deliverer. People, what we need to realize is this, is that the birth of Jesus, and I know that I'm preaching to the choir for the most part. The birth of Jesus is not just about a cute baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, a bunch of presents under a tree. Amen? The song sang it beautifully. The birth of Jesus is all about a redeemer. The birth of Jesus is all about a deliverer, a savior. And people don't realize it, but they're in bondage. And the reason that they're in bondage is because they were born the first time like their father Adam. And sin has put them in bondage. But God's promise was that a deliverer would come. And that's what it says in the city of David, a savior, which is Christ the Lord. Now listen, you don't take a nap right now. I want to make a point. If the shepherds didn't know the word of God, then the Christ child being born in the city of David doesn't mean anything. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Does that make sense? What does it mean that the Savior would be born in the city of David? It means that there's rich history. It means that the word of God had told them. And when the angel spoke out the proclamation, a shepherd, even though he's a shepherd, it would have hit a neuron in his brain and reminded him that Micah chapter 5 verse 2 had a promise, and that, hallelujah, there was a promise to the house of David. And I want to encourage you as a child of God to get in the word, amen, to get in the word and to seek the word of God so that God can begin to reveal things to you like he revealed to the shepherds. See, God wants to reveal things to people that are concerned about his word, that are concerned about what he's doing, that are concerned about his plan. Amen?
Yes.
It's a lot easier for him to reveal things to you if you've associated yourself with what it is that he's doing. So, unto you a Savior is born. And then it says this. This is the first time I ever noticed this. He said, there's going to be a sign unto you. He said, you will find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Now, dude, I don't know. I think for the longest time, I just thought a manger, not recently, but I think for the longest time, I thought a manger was that little wooden thing that they have the little nativity set up in there, you know, that they have like a little shed behind somebody's house. And so that was where the animals were and whatnot. In reality, most commentators and scholars believe that there would have been a cave See, Bethlehem or southern Judea was full of caves, and people's dwellings would oftentimes have a cave next to it where they would shelter the animals. And literally, this is just a picture. This is a picture of a cave in Bethlehem. This is just to try to give you an example of maybe what it theoretically could have looked like. That's a family that's inside of the cave. But this is literally what a manger is. A manger is a feeding trough. And so basically what's happening is that the king of the universe is being birthed in a place amongst animals, and then he's being swaddled in these cloths, and then he's being laid in an animal trough for his bed. This is one picture that I found of what it meant to swaddle. And swaddling is something that went out in about the 1700s. They would take strips of cloth and they would tie the baby down like that. They felt like it was good to protect the limbs and help the limbs to grow properly. One of the things that I noticed that in my research, some people would try to say that it was the same kind of clothes, like grave clothes, that they would mummify people with. And you know, this one particular scholar made a real big point to show the difference in the Greek words and that it wasn't really there. It would have been a real good preaching point if I could have proved it. But nevertheless, the point is this, is that they to swaddle them meant to tie them down, but not everybody could even afford the strips of cloth, which I don't really understand that. I suppose you could have made your own. But nevertheless, this was the sign. The sign was you're going to find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, and he's going to be in a feeding trough. And now you got to find him. And so, is it not something that the gospel of Jesus Christ is first announced to shepherds who are considered outcasts and ceremonially unclean as they abide in a field doing what it is that they do on their normal everyday activity? And yet at the same time, how many people were in the city who were not told that the Christ child was being born? Truth be told, many people wouldn't have probably believed it. And then one of the beautiful things is that after they're told about it, the next thing you know that they say is this: let us go now to Bethlehem and let us find this thing that we've been told about. Now, have you ever thought of that before? This is the first time I've ever really put any thought into this. This is the sign. You're going to find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and he's in a feeding trough. Now let's go find it. Now I got to go into a city. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere in the text, yes, verse 16, and they came with haste, urgency, fervency. It's not like they're just strolling down the streets of Bethlehem whistling Dixie. No, they're looking feverishly to find this sign that God had spoken to them. Running from animal shelter to animal shelter, from cave to cave, looking, which one is it going to be that has a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes? See, many times we say wise men still seek it. We talk about the wise men in the star, but I got to tell you, the shepherds were pretty wise too. They sought him. Sometimes we say that we know about Jesus. Sometimes we say we want to find Jesus. But I wonder if we're really running after him and searching for him the way that these shepherds had to, looking for him around every corner. Lord, help us to be seekers of Jesus. Yes. Help us to be fervent. Help us to be urgent. Yes. Help us, Lord, to move speedily to find you wherever it is that you may be found. Amen. Yes. And so he goes on to say in verse 17, and when they had seen it, so they showed up and they found him with haste. And there he was, the babe lying in the manger. Verse 17, and when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. The word seen in the Greek, I like this. The word seen in the Greek is eido. It's one of the words that's used in Romans chapter 6 also. This word can be used to speak physically of seeing, same way, and that's what happened with the shepherds. They physically saw the baby, but figuratively, it's also used. And what it's used of figuratively is in a spiritual way. In other words, when you've really seen it, when you really perceive it, it's though you've seen it. You understand what I'm saying? There was a long time in my life that I said that I knew Jesus. And I got to be honest with you. Even though I said I knew Jesus, and even though I knew that he died on the cross for my sin, I can remember there were plenty of times that opportunities would open up and I would get ready to tell somebody about the Lord. I'd get ready to say something about Jesus, and I was a little bit embarrassed on the inside of me, and there was a little, I shrunk back because I wasn't really ready to speak that way. I was having a conversation with a young man the other day, and he was holding on to some tracks. And I said, hey, you know what to do with that? You're supposed to hand that to somebody, and you're supposed to tell them, hey, did you know that Jesus loves you and that he died for you? And the young man says, well, that's embarrassing. And I said, yeah, I understand what you're trying to say. It's embarrassing. Jesus walked up a hill called Calvary. He carried a cross, and he hung naked in the middle of the sun for your sin. That was embarrassing for Jesus.
Amen.
But you know what? There was a time when I was just like that young man. Whenever the opportunity arose and I didn't take my opportunity to tell them about the Jesus. You know why? Because even though I thought I had seen it, I hadn't really seen it. There came a time spiritually in my life when I really saw it. And I was able to move past embarrassment. I was able to move past all that by the grace of God because it became real to me. The point that I'm trying to make is that when the shepherds saw it, yes, they saw it literally, but when they saw it, they began to noise it abroad. They began to, when they saw it with their own eyes, they began to tell everybody who would listen about the thing that God had told them. The Messiah has finally come. Thousands of years that God has been promising us and telling us that he would come, he's finally showed up. Hallelujah. And I just want to encourage you that there's going to become a day, I believe, if you'll keep seeking after God, that you'll be able to see it and you'll perceive it. Amen. And it'll be so deep on the inside of you that you're going to have to tell somebody. You're going to have to tell somebody about what Jesus has done for you. Amen. Because you see, he's the deliverer. That's what it said. Unto you a Savior is born. A deliverer is born. Good news of peace. That's what the angel told them. Good news of peace. You know what peace means? It means that two things were separate and now they've been knitted or reconnected together. Good news of peace. Humanity's been separated. Why? Because they're in bondage to their first birth. But a deliverer has come. And sometimes the truth of the matter is that when we're unwilling to noise it abroad like the shepherds, it's because we just really hadn't seen it. We either hadn't really been delivered from anything. Come on. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Has the Lord delivered you from anything? Amen. Yeah. Amen. Yes. I'm not asking you whether you're walking in sinless perfection. Jesus did that. I'm asking you, have you been delivered from anything?
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Has he set you back at peace?
Yes.
Were you separate from God? Amen. But he's brought you back. Hallelujah. Well, that was the shepherds. And just remember, there's people out there that feel like they're outcasts. There's people out there that need to know about Jesus. Amen. Amen. Verse 21, it says, when the 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus. That name means Jehovah is salvation. And in verse 22 and 23, it actually two things are taking place. And I think that this is maybe a teaching point, but I think it's pretty important. It says in verse 22 and 23, and when the days of her purification according to the law of Moses were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. There's a whole lot of history behind just those two little verses of scripture. There's two things that are happening. 8 days, really three different things that are happening that from the past history of the scriptures. Number one, God told Abraham that they were to be circumcised. Amen. And Isaac was circumcised on the eighth day. Jesus is now 8 days old and it's time for his circumcision. Number two, a woman who gave birth was ceremonially unclean and had to offer up an offering in order to be made pure, to be made clean again so that she could have come back into fellowship and be able to go to the temple to worship the Lord and all of that stuff. Whenever you read about what it says is that they actually gave the offerings, they gave either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. That proves to us and tells us that Jesus's family was poor, all right? Because you were supposed to offer up a lamb. But if you couldn't offer a lamb because you didn't have the money for it, then you would offer up these two birds. And this is what it was that they offered up. So they're here, they're there for his circumcision. They're there to the temple also. They went to Jerusalem also so that she could be made ceremonial clean. But also in verse 23, it's saying, every male that opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. They also had to pay a price to redeem Jesus. He was the firstborn. He was the first one to come out the womb. See, according to the scriptures, and once again, this is the first time that I saw this clearly. In Exodus chapter 12, we talk about this passage of scripture a lot in this church because it talks about the Passover night. And you remember the story of the Passover night. That God's children, see, we're talking about a deliverer tonight. We're talking about people being in bondage tonight. And we're talking about it, the birth of a deliverer. And God's people in Israel were in bondage to Pharaoh in Egypt. But yet on that night, God delivered them out. Amen? Take a lamb, cut its throat, paint the blood on the doorposts and the side posts. And when the death angel comes through, he's going to strike the firstborn of everything that's in the land. Everything, whether it be beast, whether it be a human, it's all going to die. But when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And then in the rest of Exodus 12, he talks about you're going to do this every year. Remember that? We focus on that a lot in this church. Every year you're going to do this. It's going to be a memorial to me. You're going to slice this lamb's throat. You're going to roast this lamb. You're going to eat this lamb. And you're going to do it every year. And it's going to almost become so monotonous, and it's going to become such a big part of your life, that your children one day are going to ask you, why is it that we do this, Dad? Why do we keep killing this lamb and roasting this lamb? Why do we eat this lamb with bitter herbs? And that's when you're going to tell them, because our God delivered us out from under the house of Pharaoh. He delivered us from out of the bondage of the enemy, out of the bondage of the world, if you will, with a mighty and a strong hand. Hallelujah. That's the God that we serve. Now, I don't know about you and what you're doing with your children, but I'm telling you, you can't tell them enough. You can't remind them enough. We read a passage out of Deuteronomy chapter 4 and also chapter 6 that said, let the word of God be written on the posts of your house. Wear it on your wrist like a bracelet. Put it on your head like a frontlet. And be reminded and tell your children when you go to sleep, you got to tell them about the plan of God. When you wake up, you got to tell them about the plan of God. When you're sitting down in your house and when you're walking up and down in the street. And I don't know if you're buying into that or not, but I'm telling you, that's what the word of God says. Hallelujah. God wants his people to know his word, and he wants you as parents to tell your children what God's plan is for their life, to serve him every day of their life. Now, you know all that. I already told you that a million times. But then in chapter 13, if you got time with me, let's turn to Exodus 13. Let's do the passage justice. We're talking about the firstborn right now. Exodus chapter 13, verse 2. Talk about the firstborn. Jesus was the firstborn. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, sanctify unto me all the firstborn, whatsoever opens the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and of beast, it is mine. Now, the word sanctify, I've taught y'all this before. It means literally two concepts, separated and holy. God makes you holy in Christ. God separates you out from the world in Christ. In the Old Testament, what he's saying is that the firstborn is separated, it's sanctified, it's mine. Now, what's interesting is this, is that on the night of the Passover, you got to understand, Exodus 13 follows right after Exodus 12. On the night of the Passover, God went through the land of Egypt and he destroyed all of their firstborn. But yet, Israel's firstborn was spared. Israel's firstborn was spared, and God said that everything that opens the womb belongs to me. He goes on to explain that if it's an animal, if it's a clean animal, then the first thing that comes out of the womb is sacrificed unto me. If it's an unclean animal, a donkey, and you don't want to take one of your lambs to redeem it, then you got to break its neck. Yeah, that, because it has to, because see, you can't offer up an unclean animal on the altar. And if it was a beast of burden and you were going to use it, it has to, it, either you're going to break its neck, or you can take one of your lambs if you need that donkey more than you need the lamb, and you can offer the lamb in its place. But then with the children, it was different. The firstborn of the child had to be redeemed with money. And it was 5 silver shekels is what the redemption was, because that had to do with the temple tax. Now, one of the things that I wanted you to see here, if you go to Exodus chapter 13, and we'll just start reading in verse 11. It says, "And it shall be when the Lord shall bring thee into the land of the Canaanites." You realize that this place right here, this little strip of land, was called Canaan before it was called Israel, right? He said, "When I bring you into the land of the Canaanites, as he swore unto thee and to thy fathers, and shall give it to thee, that you shall set apart unto the Lord all that opens the matrix," that's another word for the womb, "and every firstling that comes of a beast which thou hast, the males shall be the Lord's. And every firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. And if you will not redeem it, then you shall break his neck. And all the firstborn of man among thy children shalt thou redeem. And it shall be when your son asks you," you remember what he said in chapter 12? He said, every year you're going to kill this lamb, you're going to roast it, and you're going to eat it. And your son is going to ask you, why is it that we do this? And the Lord said the same thing's going to happen. So just imagine this. Just slow down with me. Let's think about the Bible for a second. Whenever they're doing Passover every year, it's an annual feast where they do unleavened bread and Passover every year. And so every year the entire nation is focusing and being reminded upon the fact that God delivered them from out of bondage. Does that make sense? But now this is on a more personal level. Every time a family has an animal that gives birth to the first one that it gave birth to, they have to either, if it's clean, offer it up as a sacrifice, or if it's unclean, either break its neck or offer up a sacrifice for it. And every time they have a firstborn child, a male child, they have to pay 5 silver shekels in order to redeem that child. And so every single time on a personal level that this happens, the Lord's saying, this is what you're going to do each and every time in your daily lives. And it says right here in verse 14, "And it shall be when your son asks you in the time to come, saying, what is this? That you shall say unto him, by strength of hand, the Lord brought us out from Egypt and the house of bondage. And it came to pass when the Pharaoh would hardly let us go, that the Lord slew all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both the firstborn of man and the firstborn of beast. Therefore I sacrifice to the Lord all that opens the matrix, being males, but all the firstborn of my children I redeem. And it shall be for a token upon thy hand, and for frontlets between thine eyes, and for strength of hand, for the Lord has brought us forth from Egypt." So not only was it when we eat the lamb every year, but every time we redeem something, hallelujah, we're reminded of the fact that God delivered us. Listen, God killed Egypt's firstborn, but God spared Israel's firstborn. Hallelujah. And listen to me, before that, God spared Abraham's firstborn. Somebody say, oh no, you're wrong, preacher. Abraham had a boy named Ishmael. God didn't recognize Ishmael. God said, take your son, your only begotten son, and your only son, and offer him up on a mountain that I would take. God spared Abraham's boy and put a ram in a thicket. God spared Israel's sons by giving them a lamb for a Passover. But what about God's son? What about his own precious son? God didn't spare him. He was the firstborn. And he was showing up at the temple, and they were going to have to pay a redemption price for him. But the plan was, is that I'll spare you then. And every time the firstborn opens up the womb, you're going to be reminded that I delivered you out of Egyptian bondage. And I got a plan. And I just need you to hold on to me. Because one day he's coming. My firstborn's coming. You don't have to do it, Abraham. You don't have to kill the promised seed, Isaac. And you don't, your own children won't have to die, Israel. But my son, the firstborn, he's going to be offered up. And it says right here in Numbers chapter 18, verse 15. I turned to Numbers on you. Talking about the firstborn.
Numbers 15.
Numbers 18, verse 15. Says everything that opens the matrix in all flesh which they bring unto the Lord, whether it be of men or beast, shall be thine. Nevertheless, the firstborn of man thou shalt surely redeem, and the firstling of unclean beasts thou shalt redeem. And those that are to be redeemed from a month old shalt thou redeem according to thine estimation for the money of 5 shekels after the shekel of the sanctuary, which is 20 gerahs. This is what I wanted you to see. But the firstling of a cow, or the firstling of a sheep, or the firstling of a goat, thou shalt not redeem. In other words, I don't want you to pay money for them. They are holy. Thou shalt sprinkle their blood upon the altar. You're going to offer them up as a sacrifice. And shalt burn their fat for an offering made by fire, for a sweet savor unto the Lord. Now I want you to imagine this picture. The firstborn is coming out of the womb. It's a clean animal. The sacrificial system is representative of the day that Jesus is going to die on the cross for the sins of humanity. And God says, you're going to take that firstborn animal and you're going to offer it up with its fat. It's a whole burnt offering. And what's going to happen is it's going to be a sweet smelling savor unto the Lord. Now I want you to think about this. This family is being reminded of Egypt. This family is being reminded once again of how God delivered them, but God is also being reminded of his future plan. Every single time the firstborn was offered up on the fires of the altar with the fat as a whole burnt offering and that sweet savor went into the nostrils of God, God was being reminded, I have a plan, hallelujah. There's coming a day when the firstborn is going to be born. There's coming a day when Messiah will show up just as I promised he's coming. And I just need you to trust me and continue on in what it is that I'm asking you to do, and the day is coming, hallelujah, when the angel is going to announce the birth of the Savior, amen? Mm-hmm. Now, you know, one of the things, I think I went a little too fast because I forgot to say something about those shepherds, and I'm going to have to go back a little bit. Just give me a break. You know, I was thinking about the fact that whenever that one angel gave and the announcement, and then what did it say? The host of heaven began to sing. Right? There was a heavenly choir. Let's just back up a little bit. Let's go back to the shepherds. Can you do that with me? We'll flashback. There was a heavenly host that began to sing in the choir. And the reason that I point that out is because the more I study about the pagan origins of Christmas, you did know that there was a lot of pagan origins to Christmas.
Yeah. Right.
We're going to beat up Santa Claus Wednesday. I'm telling you, I believe that's where the Lord is bringing us to. We're going to put a pop knot on Santa's head. That's what we're going to do in this church. But now, today, we're talking about Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. The darling of heaven. But in my pagan, as I've been researching all this pagan practice, one of the things that I began to see is that people are talking about the fact that you shouldn't really even be celebrating Christmas. Or they call it the Christ Mass or whatever. I don't care what you want to call it. But don't tell me not to celebrate the birth of Jesus.
Amen.
I done fought with so many Jehovah's Witnesses over this thing. I'm like, hold on a second. You mean the angel showed up and he announced, hallelujah, great joy, good tidings to all men, peace on earth, hallelujah, the deliverer's coming. And then the whole heavenly choir joined in and they began to sing a song about the Redeemer, and they celebrated the birth of the Savior. And you're going to tell me we're not supposed to celebrate the birth of the Savior? I'm not buying it. Listen to me. You can keep the stockings. You can keep the tree. You can keep the presents under the tree. I'm getting tired of all that stuff. I want to focus on Jesus. I'm not telling you you can't have it if that's what you want to do. I'm saying keep it. Keep the fat man in the red suit, and I'll just give me Jesus. And remind me every year, remind me every day, hallelujah, that he was born, and that he was born to die, and that now, even though I was separated, I can have peace with God, and my sin has been paid for, and I've been reconciled unto God. Hallelujah. I want to be reminded of that. Lord, put it in my heart and put it in my lungs to remind my children of that.
Amen.
That they might know also. Hallelujah. That the greatest gift of all is Jesus.
Amen.
Get so caught up in our commercialization.
That's right.
The firstborn. Thank you, Lord, for your firstborn. Hallelujah. Sweet Savior.
Yes.
To remind you of your plan. Let's go back to Luke chapter 2. The shepherds, once again, they were separated but visited, and now we're going to Simeon. Luke chapter 2. So while they go to the temple to for her ceremonial cleansing, for his circumcision, and for them to be able to pay this redemption of the firstborn, behold, verse 25, it says, behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. Now, I put under Simeon, as far as the point goes, he was hearing and hopeful. Now, the reason I said hearing is the name Simeon literally means to be able to hear. Simeon was hearing and he was hopeful. Simeon, it says he was devout, meaning he was careful. He paid close attention to God. He paid close attention to the things of God. And he was waiting for the consolation of Israel. Now, the word consolation there, it might need a little bit of explanation. The word in the Greek language is paraklesis. Any of you that have tried to look up certain words ought to be reminded of the word parakletos, which is an adjective used to describe the Holy Spirit. Paraklesis means to be called near. Parakletos is the one that was called alongside to help. And so it says that the Parakletos was with Simeon, but that he also was waiting for the calling near. He was waiting for the time. Once again, we're talking about Messiah. You got to remember that the people of Israel were waiting. They were hopeful and they were waiting for Messiah. But Simeon was somebody special, because God had promised Simeon that he would not die until he saw the Lord's anointed. God gave him a promise. A couple of weeks back, I preached on a Wednesday night, I believe, and I tried to tell you that, you know what, when God gives you a promise in your spirit, I mean, if God gives you a promise in your spirit, you're going to know it. When God gives you a promise in your spirit, then you need to hold on to it. When God speaks a word to you and he gives you a promise, you need to hold on to it. But let me encourage you with something. You need to know that it's the Lord. Amen? You need to seek the face of God. The reason I say that is because many a person has felt as though God gave them a promise in their spirit, and in reality, it was something that they fabricated in their flesh. Amen. And they find themselves holding on to a promise that wasn't a promise at all. And then sometimes they go about making that thing happen, and they give birth to an Ishmael. And then they spend the rest of their life with a child of the flesh, trying to convince themselves and everybody else around them that they got the promise that they were waiting on, when in reality it wasn't no promise at all. Amen. It was their flesh. Right. They created it in their own heart. They fabricated it in their own mind. Amen. They got a hold of it, and now they're living with it. Yeah. All I'm trying to tell you is be careful with that. Amen? Amen? Be careful with that. But if the Lord gave you a promise, hold on to that promise. Good news is if he never gave you a personal promise, this book's full of them. This book's full of promises. Go find you a promise. God has promised you some things in his word. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. And be hearing and be hopeful like Simeon as he waits for the consolation, the calling near. He's waiting for the calling near. Man, God came near at the birth of Jesus. And it says in verse 26, and it was revealed to him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. He came by the Spirit into the temple. And that's another thing. I didn't write this down in my notes. But God gave Simeon a promise. And look at this. God led him by the Spirit to the temple for that promise to be fulfilled. Amen? The Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you in the right direction when he's giving you a promise. Hallelujah. Doesn't mean that you'll never detour. Doesn't mean you'll never take a wrong path. But God will lead and guide you by the power of his Holy Spirit towards the promise that he's given to you. It goes on to say, and he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now let your servant depart in peace according to thy word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles. Hallelujah. That's a good word for us. That's enough for us to just stop right there and talk for a second. The word light is false. It's where we get our word phosphorus. It's the word that's used of Jesus in John chapter 1. He's the light. Amen. The second word to light the Gentiles, you'll never believe what that word is. Apocalypsis. Y'all remember that word? Where did we learn that word? In the book of Revelation? That's actually the Greek word for revelation. It means an unveiling. It means a manifestation. See, Jesus is the light to allow a revealing of God's plan to the Gentiles. The Gentiles were without light. The Gentiles were without the Word of God. But Jesus, the Word of God, became flesh. And He was the light to lighten the way to the other nations who did not know God or have God's Word, in order for them, for you, for me, to be able to hear the truth about God and to be able to come into covenant with God and to live with Him. Hallelujah. That's who Jesus is. Amen?
Amen.
And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary, he said some various things to her. He said that Jesus would cause the rise and fall of many, and that people's hearts would be revealed, and that Mary's heart would be pierced in all of this. Now let's look at verse 36, and we're about to close up. We talked about the shepherds. They were outcasts, yet they were still visited. We talked about Simeon. He was hearing and hopeful, and I wanted to make a specific point to you that he had a promise. Amen. God had given Simeon a specific promise that he was holding on to. And then we see Anna. I don't think I took too much liberty with the text. The Bible says in verse 36, there was one Anna. She was a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of 84 years. So just get a picture of this. Here's young Anna. She gets married to, I suppose, maybe the love of her life, or maybe it was an arranged marriage, but, you know, nevertheless, they were all arranged back then, but nevertheless, you know, I'm thinking that she, for every Israelite girl, that was a big deal. You know, they got married. That's what happened. You may not seem like a big deal to you, but it was a big deal for a young Jewish girl to have her husband and to be married. And she lives with her husband for 7 years, and then he's taken from her. He's no more. And for 84 years, she lived at the temple. The Bible says she didn't leave the temple. She served the Lord with fasting and prayers. You know, the difference that I saw between Simeon and Anna was that Simeon had a promise, but Anna, she had no promise. You know, yeah, she had the promise of God. She had the promise of Messiah. I'm talking about a personal promise. At least I'm looking at it that way. What she had thought would have been her promise was taken from her. But nevertheless, what she did was she served the Lord day and night in the temple with fasting and prayers. As a matter of fact, if you go to 1 Timothy, I'm not suggesting that we turn there, but 1 Timothy chapter 5, where Paul begins to speak of what a widow is supposed to look like. Anna, I think he got part of his description from the life of Anna. To serve the Lord with prayer and supplications. And then he goes on to talk about some women that say that they're widows, but the reality of it is that they're living pleasurably. And what he meant was they're going about their business, doing things the way that they want to do it, if you get my point. They're not really living the life of a widow. And in reality, he's saying you don't have to take care of them if that's how they're living their lives. But this woman lived her life devoted unto the Lord. She had lost what she loved, but yet now she's connected herself to the temple. And it says that, verse 38, she coming in that instant gave thanks likewise unto the Lord and spoke of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all these things according to the law of the Lord, they returned into Galilee, to their own city of Nazareth. So what Anna realized was the concept of redemption. Redemption means to be released through a ransom. I'm about to close. But you know, one of the things that I was thinking about Anna was this. Was that in Anna's life, she just lived for the Lord. She continued day after day waiting on God's plan. Amen. And she continued to serve Him. And you know, I was just thinking for our own lives. If there were things in our lives that we thought that we might have seen fulfilled, that we thought maybe were promises that we never saw come to pass, and when it was all said and done, what we did was we served God. We served God and we waited on Him. We waited. See, they were waiting on his first arrival, and we're waiting on his second arrival.
Amen.
And we served the Lord, and we waited on him. And I'm just wondering if in the end, that was all you had. In the end, if that was all you had, that you served him and you waited on him, and all you got to see was Jesus in the end, was it enough?
Oh, yes.
Amen. And I know that it is for many people. Yet at the same time, we got to live it out each and every day.
Amen.
And that sometimes that's when it gets a little harder, right? Mm-hmm. In the day-to-day struggle, each and every day actually going through it, crying out for grace, asking the Lord to give us strength. What a beautiful thing to be able to see the face of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
She got to see Jesus. Hallelujah. And we're going to get to see Jesus.